Sammy Davis, Jr. is star of the Will Mastin Trio, and he is currently one of the hottest nightclub acts and recording stars in the country. He's also among the most versatile. He sings, dances, mimics, clowns, and plays several musical instruments. Sammy is now only 29 years old, but he spent most of his life in show business, from Harlem to Hollywood, with its attendant successes and crises, the worst about a year ago when he lost an eye in an automobile accident. Sammy Davis now lives in this 12-room house built on the side of a hill in West Hollywood. He and his grandmother moved in about 3 months ago. Judy Garland used to live in this house, north of Sunset Strip. Now let's see what Sammy is up to.
And then the rest of the kids will come up, and I think I'll probably be the finish. They might change it around.
Evening, Sammy.
Oh, good evening, Smurl.
I hope we're not intruding.
Oh, no. We were just brushing up on the rehearsal for the Burl Show Tuesday.
Oh, yeah.
I'd like you to meet my dad, Sam Davis Sr.
Good evening.
And my uncle, Will Mastin.
Good evening, Will. Will, tell me, has Sammy been behaving himself recently?
He's a very fine boy.
Just as simple as that, is it?
That's right.
Well, Sam Sr., just how did your boy get into the show business anyway?
Well, I was working with Will, and we had a big show out, and my mother said, you got to come home to take care of the kid. And I left Will in Philadelphia, and I was away from him about 3 weeks. I went to catch a vaudeville show, and I saw some guys dancing. I said, I can dance better than them, and I called Will. He wired me a ticket. I went home and told my mother I was going back in show business. She said, I'll have your bag packed. And I went down to the Pennsylvania station, and she brought Sammy along with me. And when she went to say goodbye, she said, here's your son.
And so he's been with you ever since, has he?
Ever since.
Sammy, I know you three have been working together for a long time. You're going to keep it that way?
Oh, definitely, sir. We have enough bookings, fortunately, to go on for the next couple of years. We're doing a Broadway show this coming fall, and I guess when that's finished, my dad and uncle will probably have enough to be happy with show business and retire. I guess my uncle will, as he is now, remain my manager. My dad will probably open up a clothing store someplace.
And you'll be his best customer, I'll bet.
Oh, of course.
Let me ask your father, have you ever thought of quitting show business?
Well, I wouldn't want to quit it. It's like losing the best thing you ever had,
mm-hmm,
to quit it.
Sammy, I know your father and uncle live nearby, but where's your grandmother?
Well, she's downstairs, sir. She lives downstairs, and she's kind of nervous about TV. She's never been on it before. Dad, Will, do you think you could probably get it?
Go down and persuade her.
Persuade her to come up, yeah.
Sammy?
Yes, sir.
Do you want to talk about the auto accident?
Oh, sure. It doesn't matter. I like to put people at ease as much as possible about it. The accident was something I think that I'm a better person for. I think that it's probably the best thing that's ever happened to me. It's probably an odd thing to say. But in this business of ours, when we start to run and the good things start to happen and the door starts to finally open, a young guy gets a little too wrapped up in himself. And this was enough of a shock, a sit-down, and also a realization that there were more important things, more things to enjoy, just being a nice human being.
Well, it must have been quite a shock coming sort of at the peak of your career, wasn't it?
Yes, it was, sir, in the beginning. But then my friends rallied around me and convinced me that there was still a lot to be done and that I probably wouldn't matter. And as it turned out, it's just been so wonderful because along with the accident, I had the realization of knowing that I had so many friends.
Well, I know you have a large following of teenagers. How do you manage to win them over since you do most of your work in nightclubs?
Well, I think the records have a lot to do with it. I know that you've been very fortunate with the records being hits, I mean, going well. And secondly, those who see us in nightclubs, and surprisingly, Mr. Murrow, a lot of kids come to see us because my dad and my uncle, myself, we do a very clean act in the evening. You'll probably see like dinner shows. You'll see 6-7 families sitting ringside, which is a very wonderful thing.
Don't you do something in one of your acts about the boys from Syracuse or something like that?
Oh, it was a bit that I started to do. It actually happened. I felt kind of strange about it because this happened actually, and I finally developed it into a comedy bit. I was in Syracuse, and we worked a one-nighter, and after the one-nighter was over with, we were getting dressed in the dressing room, and all of a sudden, from outside, we heard cat calls, you know, like, all right, Sammy, come on out of here, come on, we're waiting on you, kid, come on. And I knew it was the teenage guys, and I said, all right, I'll be out in a minute, and there was a big, huge door, and I kind of pushed through the door, and here, standing in front of me, were the Amboy Dukes, replications thereof, and Blackboard Jungle guys with the boots and everything, and they were, you know, they stood like this looking at you, you know, with the shoulder pointed at you, and I walked and I said, well, fellas, what do you want to do? Do you want an autograph, or can I do something for you? And they all looked at me, and I said, incidentally, who was making the noise outside? And they said, well, nobody was. Could we have your autograph? That's all. And I kind of got the feeling that they felt, at least I'd like to think, that they felt that I was part of them, you know, one of them.
Sammy Davis, tell me, aside from your new house, what physical things has your success brought you?
I'm glad you asked me. Come. Yeah, you see, Mr. Morrow, in the old days, I was not exactly poor, but like most kids who lived in Harlem, I had a good suit, only one good suit and one good pair of shoes that I wore on Sunday. And it was kind of a strange thing, so I guess I talked it over once with Jerry Lewis, and I think we both had the same kind of feeling. When we finally made it, we would buy all the clothes that we possibly could. We couldn't go in and buy one suit, you had to buy five. You know, you couldn't go in and buy two shirts, you had to buy two dozen. And the kind of the odd thing with me with the suits is that there is a preconceived idea almost about performers wearing Sharpie clothes. So naturally, I had to buy all the Sharp clothes first. And I'd like to show you the difference. So this is an old suit I used to wear with the big shoulders. And so now that's what I have to wear because that's what people almost expect from an entertainer. And I'd like to show you the type of clothes I like to wear all the time. It's a real Madison Avenue-ish, you might say, Brooks Brothers style. And it's more comfortable. And I remember I wore it once in Boston to a teenage rally at Record Hop. And some kids, I made the mistake of wearing it, and some kids said, oh boy, big that square. You know? And this is the way I went, with no shoulders and so forth.
That has the narrow lapels too, hasn't it? Sammy, tell me, aside from clothes, what do you collect?
Oh, I collect, collect guns.
What kind of guns?
Western single-action Colts. I have a...